When you look past the next 5 to 10 years, when you look at society, when you look at markets and the economy, what do you think is the biggest risk that's on the horizon?
Well, very, very, very tough question. Looking out into the future, it is, in fact, quite hard to predict what might go wrong. No one anticipated seriously that a pandemic was going to be around the corner and have the kind of global impact that it had. Be that as it may, I am quite concerned about the impact of the changing nature of work on the human experience. Let's call it the human experience.
Well, one of the things that you had said to me before was that you don't believe we're building a world meant for humans. What does that mean?
Well, that's what I mean by the human experience. We are supposed to be building a world that we like. We everything around us is for the purpose of us. We want to have an enjoyable life. We want to live in an environment that we find pleasant. We want to have rewarding careers. We want to have an education that is enlightening. There's all these wonderful things that we can create that will make our lives rewarding and enjoyable. But that will only happen if that's exactly what we're focusing on doing.
Well, one question here is, you know, in this pandemic, one of the big winners was technology. A lot of investment into technology, more adoption of certain technologies, technologies firms raising a lot of money through IPOs and other means. Are you saying here that we're not necessarily building all the right technologies that will benefit society in the longer term?
Well, I think that we need to be very purposeful in what we're trying to accomplish. To some extent, technology takes on a life of its own. So we invent new capabilities. We have the ability to, change the way humans interact by using more virtual methods in the internet, like Zoom. All of this is quite possible. But it's quite a different story as to what people really actually would enjoy and appreciate. And so just because you can do it doesn't mean that you want this to be the way of life. So technology is a bunch of possibilities. The real challenge is, what's the best way to use all this technology to create the kind of world that we want to live in?
So help me look at this two ways. What do you think should be the better application of technology that we're not really doing enough of right now?
Well, it really isn't for me to decide. This is the a challenge for everyone. One of the reasons that in America, we, and much of the world, we have a democracy and we elect people to represent us, is that we get to shape the world that we live in. And it shouldn't be left to a couple of people to decide how should the world work. And so we need to, together, through our government and other other ways to influence public policy, we need to work together to make sure that we're moving in a direction that, look, you're never going to make everyone happy, but we have to find a way to make most people happy. So it's not up to me to decide, I'm a smart guy, I think the world should work that way. That's not the right way to think about it.
So help me understand, what is the right way to think about it? If you were advising a government official or a technologist here, what are some of the things that could be creating a society that is more meant for humans?
Well, I think it really does have to start with having better metrics for trying to gauge, are we happy with our society? GDP, for example, is often the metric that people focus on. And if GDP is going up, then a lot of people would conclude that we're doing a great job. But I think that GDP is an overly simple measure. It's just one number. Quality of life is not necessarily measured by, in fact, quite is not exactly correlated with GDP. It's really quite a different story. In addition, GDP isn't measuring, how the rewards are actually divvied up. You might have very inequitable growth. At the very least, I think everyone can agree that as society evolves into something much more influenced by technology, the benefits really have to go to a broad range of people. It can't just go to, you know, a very small minority of the population.
So is that kind of the root of your concern here, the inequality that's stemming from kind of this surge in technology? Or what is the root of your concern that is behind the way technology is being used today?
It's a little bit much broader than just the inequality. So for example, just take the ability to go virtual for everything. So we've kind of shown during the pandemic that a lot of people, not everyone, a lot of people can do all their shopping from home, they can work from home, they can get entertained from home. You know, they don't really need the built environment. They can sit in a room and watch a movie, they can buy whatever food that they need, they can connect to their friends, they can keep in touch via various kinds of social networking. So we don't really have to emerge from our environment. And so technology does make that possible. And not only during the pandemic, but we've been experimenting with this way of living, for the last 10 or 15 years as the technology has all come together. I think in the end though, that's probably not what we want. I think people want to have a much broader range of experiences than what they could achieve by just sitting on their couch using various technological inventions.
So you had mentioned that GDP, for example, might not be the best way to measure the productivity that's coming out of this new economy that we're building. Do you have any suggestions on new ways to start measuring the success of our society?
Well, it turns out that how society is doing, just like how a business is doing, is very hard to capture in one number. Ultimately, there are a lot of different things that you would actually need to measure to get a picture, a snapshot of how we're doing. Things concerning health, things concerning even, a lot of people don't like to become so touchy-feely, but just measurements of happiness and satisfaction. We need to also measure how fairly things are being divided up among people. So the short answer here is that the measurement of the health of a society is a very hard problem. And because it's a hard problem, people have tried to oversimplify it down to one or two numbers, which I think is quite inappropriate.
Do you think also, and I'm wondering how you're viewing this issue, what is the ultimate impact of technology on jobs? Are you worried about, for example, the rise in joblessness that it could have the potential to create, or is it a different issue entirely for you?
I'm not worried about there being a lack of jobs in the future. There is plenty of work to do for people to do. We're not going to run out of work. The question is that will this be work that people want to do, and will it be work that pays well enough? Let me give an example that we can through the gig economy, as we've learned, get rid of to a large extent traditional employment, and we can create essentially an app that will tell you what to do. A good example might be Uber. And so you can you don't really need to do much. You can if you want to be an Uber driver, you can get the app, and then the app will tell you what to do. It will tell you who to pick up. It will automatically collect the fares for you. You become essentially a peripheral. You're connected to Uber through the app. Now, people might enjoy this to some extent because it gives you the flexibility to work when you want to. But on the other hand, I think it would be hard to argue this is a meaningful career. You're really not learning any new skills. You're at the mercy of the algorithms that Uber has put on the app. And I'm not here singling out Uber. What I'm really trying to focus on is that we have the ability through nature through technology to change the nature of work. And these changes may not be good for people.
So I want to understand how, in addition to Two Sigma, I know that personally you also spend a lot of time on these issues, and there are different ways that you try to tackle this problem. What are some of the most immediate ways that you are trying to attack the issue of how society is being changed by the technologies that are arising?
Well, I think that a key A key part of this is to raise awareness, as I'm trying to do even right now, that we should not be innocent bystanders as the world changes around us. We have to be part of the process of making these changes occur in a way that we like. If we feel that essentially we are detached from, in other words, the world will change and we don't have any agency, it will become something and we'll have to put up with what it is, I think we're going to have a bad outcome. On the other hand, if we become essentially part of the transition, by paying attention to who we're electing and how democratic functions operate, and through our own personal education, would lead to a better outcome. And my fear really is that people are becoming too detached and they just sort of watch what's happening and they just put their arms up in the air and they say, well, I don't know what's going on, but I have no control over it.
Now, part of this change and activity that comes with changing the way that the technology works around us, some of that comes, as you mentioned, through elected officials and choosing the people in power that help shape these decisions. Some of it comes through investment as well. You had mentioned technology as one area, as a more useful application for some technologies. Are you speaking to investors and through your own funds, are you finding more ways to put money to work through more productive technologies?
Look, I think that's a terrific question. I think that fundamentally, investments and businesses need to operate putting essentially the health of their business first. I don't think we can have this expectation that somehow through corporate social responsibility, we're going to solve all the problems of our society. It's never worked that way in the past. That being said, I do believe that there are investment opportunities out there that will deliver excellent returns that take into account the workforce and the impact that the investing will have on society. Let me first look at it from the other side, which is people have been investing remarkable levels over the last 10 or 15 years in trying to create technologies that will reduce the need for human labor. AI, various kinds of automation have been created and are continuing to advance that will make human labor less important in a range of job functions. And that's totally fine because the technology can generate incredible efficiencies, which will lower the cost of delivering the services. There's nothing wrong with companies pursuing that. That's been going on for hundreds of years, really nothing new here. But on the other hand, I think that there are missed opportunities where we can invest more in ways to take advantage of the capabilities and skills and the unique abilities of humans. Humans are, we have empathy, we're much more creative than algorithms. We're very dexterous, we're very flexible. We shouldn't become so pessimistic about what a human can actually do. And so the opportunity, and we're looking at this in one of our private equity funds, there's an opportunity to essentially put more value into the unique abilities of humans.
So I would love to get your insights on this a little bit more. And I assume you're talking about your impact fund, correct?
Yeah.
So how does that work then? I mean, what types of opportunities are to invest in people?
People are involved with virtually everything. So the reality of it is that we, meaning people, are needed to provide healthcare. We're needed to provide education. There are a range of services that only people can provide, and they can provide well. Humans are a big, big part of the economy, and they're not going away. But the question is, how can you most effectively combine together the incredible abilities that we have? And please, none of us should become demoralized by the advances in AI. We're still far superior to any algorithm anyone's created. And that's not going to change even in a generation. So the trick, though, is to combine together the best of what we as humans have to offer with the ability of technology and algorithms to make things more efficient. This kind of combination, I think is a very promising a path to not only improve the efficiency of society, but to improve the outcomes that we have as people to make our lives better.
So I'd be remiss not to ask you about the future of quantitative investing, because you've been known for being at the forefront of it. But when you look ahead and you look at AI and you look at technology and quantitative skills, what's the next frontier that you see? You know, I know that you're looking at private markets. I know you're looking at market making. What's the next frontier for Wall Street when it comes to quantitative skills?
Well, you know, for a really long period of time, you know, many generations, advances in technology have driven advances in business, advances in investing. It's really an ongoing process. Technology and, you know, AI in particular, these methods are still pretty much brand new. And what we're finding is that the data that is out there in the world, the new algorithms and capabilities that we're developing really allow optimization and improvement and efficiency gains throughout all aspects of our lives. And so there, I'm looking at this as the first inning. You know, we're not anywhere near, figuring out how best to utilize the most recent advances in technology to make better investment decisions. This is just an early part of the game. I also think that we have plenty of opportunities to apply these new advances, AI methods, in particular, to other fields like healthcare. And so fundamentally, I'm incredibly optimistic that we will build a much better world with the advancement in technology that, you know, has been happening at an incredible pace over, in my lifetime.
So one of the things you had mentioned earlier was that there's an opportunity of elected officials to really be shaping the way that we are shaped by our technology. What role do you think regulation will play?
Everything, any part of our economy that is even a little bit important has regulation. There are all these three-letter regulatory agencies. The SEC is regulating the financial world. FAA is regulating aviation. We've got the FDA. There's a big list of regulatory bodies that have been created over time, as we have discovered that the businesses alone don't have the incentives to make the right decisions for the benefit of society. This is not new. It's not controversial. In fact, in a way, businesses are happy about this, because without the regulation, then it kind of becomes a race to the bottom, where someone who wants to be abusive can get an advantage over some other firm that doesn't want to be as abusive. So the purpose of regulation, in my mind, it's not meant to be the heavy hand of the government telling companies how they should run, but it really is an opportunity for society to create, essentially the rules of the game. And it's a partnership, and these work hand in hand. And so as technology has become more important in our society, and as we learn that the impact that technology has on our lives, there needs to be a reflection on, what rules should the government be creating to make the outcomes be compatible with what we want? This is not, a controversial statement, I think.
Is there anything about the worries that you have about the rising technologies in the world that I didn't ask you about the next big risk that's on the horizon that we're trying to tackle?
We've covered it broadly, but I'd like to really emphasize that I think that the opportunities are enormous. And, I am not one of these people that I'm not afraid that AI is going to ruin the world. I don't think that We are on a path that is terribly regrettable. I'm quite the opposite. I'm extremely optimistic. I just think that we have to all have a level of caution that makes sure that we don't go in a direction that is really not what we want. And so we have to be purposeful about this. But the good news is that the technology advances that have occurred and that we're talking about here today are truly remarkable. And they can bring and will continue to bring enormous benefit to society. We just have to make sure that the path we take is one that truly brings benefit to all of us in a way that we all want.
David, thank you so much for doing this with me. I'm very excited to share this story at the beginning of this year. So I appreciate all of your time and your help with this project. It'll all start to roll out next week.
Yep, you're very welcome. It's a pleasure to be part of it.